feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Deeper than my feet could ever wander, my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you are mine.
bridge. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. As we go into this next song, It Is Well, it's the modern day version of the hymn by Horatio Spafford, It Is Well. And a passage of scripture that God brought to me in preparation for this morning was Jesus calming the storm. And it's great to see in three of the Gospels, this storm is presented. And in Luke chapter 8, verses 22 through 25, the Word of God says, one day Jesus says to his disciples, let us go over to the other side of the lake. So they got into a boat and set out. And as they sailed, he fell asleep. A squall came down on the lake so that the boat was being swamped and they were in great danger. The disciples went and woke him saying, Master, Master, we're going to drown. He got up and he rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided and all was calm. Where is your faith? He asked his disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, who is this? He commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him. And leading into this passage, this was at evening time, and Jesus said, we're going to go to the other side. And during this whole day, Jesus was busy. He was busy healing. He was busy casting out demons. He was busy drawing people to himself. And he was tired. And he says to his disciples, let us go to the other side of the lake. But when this storm came and raged, and most of these disciples were fishermen. Most of them were fishermen, so you would think that they had been in the experience of dealing with storms and battles of weather. But it got to be so raging amongst them that they were so scared for their life that they went and woke Jesus up. And then Jesus calms the storm around them. Each and every one of us, guys, if we're real with one another, not just on a Sunday morning where it's easy to say how you're doing and I'm doing fine, but inside, you've got raging waters of doubt, of worry, of fear. But Jesus comes, and he says to be still. But he draws us into relationship with himself. The most important thing that we can do is have that relationship with Jesus Christ. And that is what he was developing with these 12 men, was a relationship with him. So as we go into this next song, It Is Well, in the bridge it says, so let go my soul and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. So whatever you're battling, brother or sister, this morning, Jesus can calm the waves and the wind of the turmoil that is going on around in your life right now on this Sunday morning. As you stand or sit or watch what you're dealing with, Jesus wants to calm that storm. So let's sing It As Well.
Thank you.
something that I know for each and every one of us that I can safely say is very difficult. But Father, your word tells us to fear not, for you are with us. Just like with the disciples on that lake when the storm was raging, you said, quiet, be still. Why are you so afraid? Have faith in me. So Father, we humbly come before you this morning in confession of our fear, of our anxiety, of our worry, of our guilt, of our bitterness, of the raging sea within us. Father, this day, may we declare that indeed Jesus Christ is Lord, that he is King. And as your word says, that one day, every knee will bow and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father, be continually honored and glorified this morning by all that is done and said. May your name be praised. May you be lifted up. Father, thank you for bringing us here this day. Continue to do your work in our hearts this morning. And we boldly come before the throne of grace. In the precious Holy Son's name of Jesus, all God's people say. Gentlemen, will please come forward for the tithes and offering.
It's great to see everybody here today. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that we can come into your house today, Lord, and we can worship and we can just be encouraged through your word, God. And I pray that, Lord, we'll take this every day where we're going, that we're not just relying on one day of the week to fill us for the rest of the week, Lord, that we're taking this everywhere we go. We're taking your love and your goodness and your kindness, Lord, to everybody we meet. Lord, may you continue to use the tithes and offerings that we're about to give, Lord, to further your kingdom, not just here, but around the world. We just continue to lift up those we know that are facing a lot of hardships, Lord, not just in our own community, but beyond, Lord. There's a lot of people that we know all over the world, Lord, that are struggling, that are trying to help those in need. And we pray, Lord, that what we're giving today and what we continue to give will help people and further your kingdom. For your glory and honor, Lord, we pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning, guys. I'm having me, I'll be in the foyer after one service is over. I kept saying between services. It's $8 a person. It includes your skate rental. If you need one of those skate mates, the PVC pipe thing, that is extra. I think it's $4, but that's beside. It's going to be great, so come get your tickets, and we're going to have fun. And, okay, what else was I just saying? Check the website for all the other stuff. And next week is Spring Forward. Yes. Lots of sunshine.
Good morning, church. So I have a pastoral prayer this morning, and I was reminded this week of just our reverence in prayer and worship. And what I mean by that is our diligence in creating space and time in our busy lives to do those things. Kids may be dismissed. I didn't know what was going on.
I'm out tea.
It's like we're landing an airplane. Sorry, kids. So anyway, that reverence in our hearts to, you know, be steadfast to prayer and worshiping the Lord, creating spaces in our week to do that. And I think the last couple weeks for a lot of us, you know, or at least for me, my thoughts have wandered and have been wild to comprehend, right? What's going on in our world, what's going on in our country, and the way, you know, things are going, right? And so there, my mind, you know, runs off a little bit. Does anybody else do that? Like, you know, when you're sitting in bed and right before you go to sleep, that time where you're like, and all those thoughts, they start rolling and scrolling, you know, or when you first wake up and you have all those thoughts. And so I found a passage in Psalm 57 here. I'm going to read it. And David, I'm sure, had some thoughts like this while he was in a cave, right? So this week, I think for me, in a lot of ways, I had a cave moment where I just got to sit and think and reflect, you know, and this, I want you to pay attention into here where David goes and where he returns back to, you know, after what is going on in the world is kind of crushing in on him. If you have your Bibles, turn to Psalm 57. Be gracious to me, O God, be gracious to me, for my soul takes refuge in you, and in the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until destruction passes by. I will call to God Most High, to God who accomplishes all things for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He reproaches him who tramples upon me. God will send his loving kindness and his truth. My soul is among lions. I am lying down among those who breathe forth fire. Sons of men whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue a sharp sword. Listen to this. Be exalted above the heavens. Where's your return, O God? Let your glory be above all the earth. They have set a net for my steps. My soul is bowed down. They dug a pit before me. They themselves have fallen into the midst of it. My heart is set. O God, my heart is set. I will sing. Yes, I will sing praises. Awake, my glory, awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. That's how loud he's going to praise the Lord. Do you do that in the morning? I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the people. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your loving kindness is great to the heavens and your truth to the skies. Be exalted above the heavens, O God. Let your glory be above all of the earth. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day that you have given to us. We just pray that you would be upon our hearts and minds. We're here this morning as your church because we want to hear from you. We want to hear your word. We want to worship you, Jesus. We want you to be seated in the right place this morning. In our hearts and in our minds, God, I pray that we would open up our hearts and open up our minds and be willing to change. God, I pray that we would be willing to humble ourselves, to recognize your word and the truth that it holds, God. I pray that you would just go before us now as we hear Pastor Jeff come, and I pray that you would be over him and just bless him as he delivers your word, Lord God, and we just pray that our ears would be open to what you have to say to us this morning. We ask this in your name. Amen.
All right, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Let me tell you how good it is to see everybody here this morning. To have a packed house, to have everyone worshiping together, it is good. When we sang "It Is Well With My Soul," it is very good. See everybody here this morning. It's been a long 2.5 years. Long 2.5 years of just missing one another. My favorite thing this morning was just the faces of each other lighting up for people you haven't seen in months, if not years. And it just does my heart good. We need to be together. And I am just so thankful that we are here. All back together. I think it was an incredibly wise move by the elders to go to one service. I was always like, come on, we're going to instantly go right back to two if we do that. No, we needed this. We needed this. And as I was preparing this week, I really feel that God has called us together because the message that we have this morning is not an easy one to hear. And I think he's called us all together because he wants to encourage us with what his word says. So turn your Bibles to Ephesians 2, because I have to start in Ephesians 2 to get to James. We are going to keep rolling through James. But before we begin, I really want to pray and invite the Holy Spirit into our time together. So let's pray. Father, we walk in these doors distracted. We walk into these doors with a set of priorities, Lord, that are not yours. And Father, as we worship, the entire world began to wash away. Father, I thank you for our time of worship together. I thank you for giving us each other, that we're not in this world alone. We're not in this battle that we're fighting alone. We can encourage one another, spur one another. God, you are an amazing God. Lord, I pray that as we go through your word this morning, that you would get rid of the calluses that are on our hearts, where we have lost sensitivity to your spirit, that we might hear from you and see in your word clearly. I praise you for your mercy and your goodness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before I begin, there's a couple kind of announcements that I want to do. I'm kind of hijacking the announcements from earlier. This week, Marion started up a Bible study. What time is it on Mondays? Fridays, I mean? It's at 1. It's from 1 to 2:30, and there's childcare. So please come on out. It's a fantastic thing. I have you all here. I know you can find it on the website, but I want you to go. So women, it's a women's Bible study. Sorry, guys. So make sure you go out to that and enjoy your time with that. I don't know about you, but did you get an email from Bob and Heidi Winslow this week? This is what is going on. If you don't know Bob and Heidi Winslow, they are our missionaries in France. They're kind of on the border of France and Switzerland. They're right outside of Geneva. And Bob has been watching what's going on in Europe and is quite a bit closer. We can watch on the news and we can see some of the things that are going on, but they're beginning to feel it. They see the fear. They see all of that is going on. And Bob and Heidi got on their knees and prayed, God, what can we do? We just feel helpless. We feel hopeless. We know that you're not helpless, God. What can we do? And God has directed them to go and to buy a 4x4 truck. I don't know if it's a truck, a van, something big. Because they're going to the Ukraine border to pick up women and children and take them the 6-hour drive to safety where they need to be once they cross that border. Because what is happening is that there are people waiting at the border for them that are trafficking the children and women because there are very few men that are coming across with their families. So Bob and Heidi want to get people to safety, and so they are raising funds for that. Please see me afterwards if you are interested in giving for that. If you were to put it on a check or whatever, you can give, but put in the memo for Bob and Heidi's Ukraine mission. And we will make sure it gets where it needs to go. But we want to get behind them. They need the money as soon as possible because they actually have to go buy the car. He's all packed. He's just waiting for the money, and he's going to get to the border. This is going to be quite a long ministry to be able to do this, and who knows who he's going to run into and what is going to blow up into that ministry as he goes. But just be praying for them and know that they're... They were spurred to action, not because it's good to do, but because of the God they love. And that's what we're going to be talking about this morning. So, like I said, we have to set up what is going on in James by starting in Ephesians 2. So turn your Bibles to Ephesians 2, and we're going to look at verse 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. So we have to start with this understanding, because James is going to go and take this from a completely different angle. But this verse says, it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. That's it. There is not anything you can do to make up for your sins. I remember when I was in eighth grade, I went to go play. We had an all-school floor hockey tournament. And my brother and I had trained for this for quite a long time. We, not specifically for that, when they had the floor hockey tournament, we were excited. But growing up, all we did was play hockey out in the street. And he was always the goalie, and I would just learn, and I knew how to shoot and score on him pretty easily, but he was an incredibly good goalie. And so we went and we played in this tournament. He was on one team, and I was on the other. And we both made it to the finals. It was my team versus his team. And we were winning because I could score on my brother. And in the middle of this game, I go up to score, and a friend of his comes and slides my legs out from underneath me. I go to stand up, and my entire knee just buckles. I had torn almost everything in my knee, and it literally was just kind of flopping there. Instantly, it swelled, and it looked absolutely atrocious. It was purple by the time I made it out of the gym. The kid who had slid my legs out from underneath me felt horrible. He even came up to me during this. It was one of the days in school while I'm on crutches. I missed basketball season. I missed tennis season. And it was just a rough time. And he walked up and handed me his car keys. And he said, I have nothing else. I'll give you my car. And I remember just looking at his face and like, it's okay. I mean, these things happen. But there was a part in him that he knew there is nothing he could do to make up for what had happened. There is nothing that he could do that could make up for what he had done. Not that we lost the game after that, which made actually me feel very important. But not that we lost, not that I missed basketball season, not that I missed tennis season, but just he felt like there was nothing he could do, that he was trapped with guilt and shame, and there was nothing he could do to make up for that. And we have to understand one of the core principles of Christianity, and one of the only religions, actually the only religion, that it is not what we do that brings us salvation. It is what Jesus Christ did when he died on the cross. So if you're here and you're trying to earn your way, you're trying to be good enough to be forgiven, to be good enough to earn your way to salvation. Remember the guy who comes up to Jesus and says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" I'm sure there's a part inside Jesus where he was like, "I have to do it." But he shares with him exactly what he thinks. Well, you've got to keep these laws. You've got to do all of these things. You've got to act this way. And he says, well, then what am I still missing? And Jesus says, well, sell all you have and come and follow me. In other words, it's not about what you do. It's not about what you have. It's not about what you've gained in this world. It's about who you have. And Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, that you might have forgiveness. All you have to do is believe. It was grace that he offers you this. It is grace. It's not by your works. It's not, oh, you know what? He knew Jeff was going to be the super cool guy, so he offered him salvation, and that's why he died. No. While I was still a sinner, he died for me. So there is no ifs, ands, or buts. That there is nothing that I do that earns salvation. All God asks from me is to believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross. So if you're waiting for some type of special knowledge, if you're waiting to be good enough, if you're waiting for your life to change before you come into relationship with him, you're doing it backwards. He wants a relationship with you. So he says it is by grace that you have been saved. It is grace that he has handed it to you. And so we need to sit back and take a deep breath, because I know a lot of you. Actually, I know pretty much all of you, except for a couple that just came in for the first time this week. But I know your love for Jesus Christ. I know the relationship that you have started with him. Take joy in it. That is not anything that you have to do. That way we don't boast in ourselves, but we can boast in our salvation of who Jesus is and what he has done for us. Is that abundantly clear? You did nothing and can do nothing to make up for your sin. You did nothing and can do nothing to earn God's favor. You are his child. He paid the ultimate price for you, so that if you believe in him, you may not perish, but have everlasting life and be able to live with him forever. Because he wants you. That was his choice, his gift. And now listen again to verse 9. Not by works, so that no one can boast. Do me a favor and turn over to James 2. Now listen to what James says. James says this. We're looking at James 2, verse 14. I always forget to tell you the address of where we are, so please just raise your hand and be like, where are we? I don't mind. You can interrupt. That's okay. So we're in James 2, verse 14. James is almost all the way at the end of the Bible. And it says this. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds, can such faith save them? Now we have a problem. This is a conundrum. This is an issue that has plagued the church for years. People have come and they have argued, but you don't understand. Scripture is constantly talking about obedience. It's constantly talking about I need to obey, that the things that I do really do matter. And here James is saying, if you say you have faith, but you don't have works, can you be saved? We just saw Paul writing that it's not about works. And then James comes alongside and says, listen, if you don't have works, you can't be saved. Now remember, I built a foundation for you to start with. It is by grace that we are saved. So if you fall asleep, do not sit there and be like, well, Jeff says no. 100%, that is our foundation. So is James wrong? No. Of course not. James is coming at it from a little bit of a different angle, and he's coming at it exactly how Jesus does. But let us keep reading James so we can understand. He says, if one of you says to them, can such a faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well-fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Turn your Bibles over to Matthew 7. Keep your finger in James, because we're going to come back to it. We're going to see, remember what I told you, in James is a reflection of the Sermon on the Mount, and the Sermon on the Mount is found in Matthew 5 through 7. And so here is what Jesus has to say, and this is where James is getting what he is saying. Now this is the hardest thing for a pastor to read or to preach to his congregation. Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Heavenly Father, Lord, none of us, please. Holy Spirit, will you come and convict any of us who have settled for works and not a relationship with you? Who have been so self-deceived that we believe we know you and we don't. Lord, anyone in the sound of my voice, Father, will you bring conviction and open their eyes? Amen. Now, did you hear what Jesus says? These are the words of Jesus, and he says, listen, I know what's coming at the end. What's coming at the end is there's going to be people who come to me and say, Lord, Lord. And a lot of times we leave it at that when we preach. But it even goes further than that. He says, there will be people who can cast out demons in my name. There will be people who prophesy in my name. There will be people who have walked, who have thought they knew me and never knew me at all. Because they believe that what they do is how they get in. And James is sitting here saying, listen, what kind of faith do these people have? Do they have faith in Jesus? Do they believe in him? Because your faith is going to be proved out by how you live. And we have to fully understand that and grasp it. And I want you to wrestle with this today. I don't want you to doubt salvation, but I want you to question where you stand. Because what James is telling us, and we're going to finish going through this, but if you hear nothing else, hear this. What James is telling us is that when you come to Christ, when you have a relationship with Christ, everything changes because there is power in Jesus Christ. There is an amazing thing that happens when I have a relationship with him. It has to change. Things have to happen. And I am so tired of watching people settle for calling themselves faithful. And there is no fruit at all in our lives. And we're okay with that. We have buried too many people over the past month. Too many people for us to just sit back and say, hey, you know what? Just go about life as long as you say you believe, you're okay. Man, that's a terrifying thing. And I want none of you to walk out of here today just assuming that you've got this because you're here. I want you to walk out of here saying, God, I want more of you. Because the more of you I have, the more of me I get to be. And the fuller I get to be. And it's about a relationship with him. It's not about all the good things that are done. And so what my challenge is, the same challenge that James has. And that challenge is this. Is your faith proved out by how you live? Jesus had Peter, right, who walked away from everything that he had. Walked away from his family business and all of that to follow Jesus. And in the story that Johnny read this morning, as the boat is being rocked, he is terrified. When push comes to shove, what he trusted in and what he believed in began to come out. And did he believe that Jesus Christ was there and he was going to save them and that he was Lord, sovereign over all and his Savior? No, that's why Jesus looks at him and goes, where's your faith? Jesus knew what faith they had by what they did. So James goes on to say this. James says this. But some of you will say, you have faith and I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds and I will show you my faith by my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that. And they have the good sense to shudder. James goes straight after the Jewish people who had accepted Christ because he is going after what's called the Shema. It's the one thing they would say over and over again. Every Jew at least knew this phrase that I am the Lord your God, the Lord is one. And he says, listen, you can say the Shema, You can say that over and over again. Many of you can say the Lord's Prayer, but my question is, are you praying to Him, and are you seeking that relationship with Him? When you sit back and say, Our Father, does it just stop you in your tracks to say, you picked me to be your child, you've adopted me? Or is it the rote thing that we say to get through it? Do you see what James is saying? James is saying, listen, you can say all of the right things. You can know all of the right things. But if you don't believe it, if you don't have faith, if you don't trust, I love that song. Just God, give me trust without borders. How many of us have really tiny borders? We have guardrails going over a bridge that only one car can go over. Give me a trust that's without borders. Why? Because I serve a God who can do immeasurably more than I can hope or imagine. That's the God who I get to call Father. That should change my life. It should change every one of us. But how many of you this week did your faith make no difference in your week? Say you have faith. Is that a faith that can save you? Or is a faith that can save you one that can't be contained inside this body? That faith just oozes out and it changes everything about what I do. Look at what he says from the very beginning. He says, listen, does that faith save you? Well, let's say this. Let's say there's somebody in your congregation who has no clothes or has no food. Did you hear the word he used? They don't have the daily bread. And you turn and say, you know what? Go in peace. Be warm and well fed. What good is it? How many of you sit back and see a brother or sister, and he's talking about in your congregation. He's talking about somebody you know well, and you just let them go hungry. He says, how is that possible? Because faith always works itself out in love. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Let's just stop on that one. There's fruit that comes out of our lives, and love is the number one thing that should be pouring out of us. Why? Because I'm not spending my life trying to get love. I'm already full because He's given me everything I need. And if I had needed more, He would give it to me. And so I am desperately asking you, please do not read James and walk away and say, checked it, I'm good. James is saying, no, do you have a faith that makes a difference? Because the demons even believe and they shudder. And he's coming to them. How many of you are shuddering at the fear of the Lord? At knowing who He is and how great and majestic He is. How many of you shudder? We don't. We just go about our days as if it makes no difference. So he's saying, do you really believe that? Because if you really believe, it's going to change. And so I love the prayer of the songs we were singing. Give me a trust for you that's without borders, because I keep hemming you in. As if I provide food for somebody who needs it that you're not going to provide for me. That I need to store up in my bank account all of these things and all this excess. Instead of just being love and trusting you. I love what Bob and Heidi's response was. Bob and Heidi could not sit still. They are 17 hours from the border. They said, we can get there. We can do something. And God, you love these people. These are your children. You are more powerful than anything. We're just going to put a crazy call out there. Can people give us enough money so that we can get a car and at least keep maybe a dozen people out of being trafficked? If it's one person, it is worth everything. Because God, your children cannot be treated this way. So God, we want to be your hands and your feet. And so what he is saying here in James, when he says, listen, when somebody is not clothed well, and they're cold, and they are hungry, and you just tell them, go in peace, be warm and well fed, you do not understand that God wants to use you to be the one who provides for them. That he will provide for them through you. And what an amazing thing when God calls us to partner with him. When God calls us to walk with him and be partners with him. And so, my question for you is, what is your faith? What good is it? What good is your faith? Is it just lip service? Is it just a bunch of knowledge? The fruits of the Spirit should be pouring out of you. There should be love and joy. That's a hard one, isn't it? Now, this isn't something that we're talking about to perform. This is to look in and say, why am I not a joyful person? What do you have to not be joyful over? If you truly believe that you've sinned against the God who created everything, that you deserve hell and eternal punishment, and God decided to do something about that, and to save you, and not only to save you, but to adopt you, to make you his, to call you his child, to make you an heir with his son, to love you and adore you, to provide all that you need to care for you. If you believe that, shouldn't that change everything? But we take our salvation for granted. We take what our God has done for us and we put it on the back burner and we live our lives the way we see fit. Mediocre Christianity is no Christianity at all. James is saying that plain and simple. If your faith is not proved by action. Now remember, it's not the other way around. It is not that your actions get you somewhere, but your actions are a big tell of what you truly believe. So if I were to just take this last month and play it before you as a scrolling video, what would you be able to tell me you believe? What would be your core beliefs? If you saw the life that you're living currently, would it show that you believe that you are a forgiven, fully accepted, loved child of God? Would it show that there is a God who cares for others? What difference does your faith make? My biggest fear, and I will call it fear, is that one of you will go before the Lord and say, Lord, Lord, I was a Sunday school teacher. Lord, Lord, I was an usher for you. Lord, Lord, I was on the worship team and sang for you. And Jesus looks at you and says, but you never knew me. What good is our faith if it's not proved out? Now, I am not advocating performance. I don't want everyone here to start, oh, man, I got to brush it up and I've got to start doing better things. That's not the point. The point is you need to start asking why. Why would I need to then perform? Maybe I need to change what's inside. So God, will you give me a trust that's without borders? Will you give me a love for others because of what I see you do in my life? So for most of you, it's not a change in behavior that's going to need to happen. It's going to need to be a change of where your eyes are. Because if you spend this week, this month, this year, looking at what God is doing in your life will respond in gratitude. your life will respond in joy, in love, in peace, in patience, in kindness, in goodness, in faithfulness, and in self-control. But if we don't have those, then it tells me there's something missing. So again, this is not a performance. Step up your performance, Trinity. No. It's not what I'm asking. I'm asking you to go back, ask Jesus, how are we? How is it between you and me? Do I really trust you? That was Jesus' point with the men who were in that storm. He says, where's your faith? I'm right here. Did it help them grow in their faith? Yes. Next time there's a storm, Peter asks if he can get out of the boat. There's a big difference. Because he trusted Jesus. Well, does he sink? Yes, but that's another story. My question for you, do you have a genuine relationship with Jesus Christ? A genuine, life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ? Or have you found a way to fit religion into your life? So that you don't have to change. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that we would not blow off the conviction of your Spirit this morning. I pray that we would be able to take a look in the mirror, that we would look at our relationship with you, that we might be able to see ourselves clearly. Father, I praise you for James, who was bold enough to challenge us. Not to change theology, but to challenge who we are at our core. So, Father, I ask you would come and you would change our beliefs. Help us with our unbelief. Help us with our fear. Help us with our faith. Give us more. Give us wisdom, Father. Thank you for the grace and the mercy that you have poured out on this family here. You're so good to us. Help us to see that more clearly. Help us to live as children who love you, who obey you, who serve you, because you are sovereign over our lives. You are our Messiah. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name I pray. If I could have the elders come forward. We have an opportunity to do communion all together. This I've been looking forward to since we announced that we were doing one service together. That we would come before Christ, come before his table together, united to be able to have communion together. Communion was meant to be something that was encouraging to one another. It was meant to be a time where we come before the Lord together, sharing a meal with one another, celebrating what Jesus Christ has done. But as he has warned in his word, do not take this and not know it. This is an opportunity for you to truly be able to say, Lord, I know you. You know me. Let's eat together. Be reminded of what Jesus Christ has done. Because it was when he was on, the night before he was going to be betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, this is my body broken for you. And we do this to remember because we constantly forget. He knew that about us. He knew that this was something that we would take for granted all the time. So for a minute, stop taking it for granted. Let's look at the bread. Let's look at what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Let's be grateful and allow that gratitude to flow out of our lives. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to have communion with one another. I thank you for the unity that is here in this body. God, I thank you for this one service that we can stand all together. Lord, I pray that you would just bind our hearts together, spurring one another on. Jesus, we thank you for what you have done on the cross for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. First layer, if you're already at the juice, hang on. It's not an easy thing. Trying to do this with a microphone is even more difficult. We will get back. We will. But no matter what this looks like, it's still a symbol of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Praise our Father in heaven that Jesus Christ allowed his body to be broken for you. You're forgiven. If there's anybody here who is struggling with being forgiven for anything, like my friend Corey, after he slid my leg out, he was like, there's nothing I can do to make up for it. You're right. But Jesus did something. He allowed his body to be broken. And so look at me. You are forgiven. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. His body was broken for you. The power of sin has no longer any grip on you. Let's do this in remembrance of him. night he took the cup and he poured it out. And as he was pouring it, he said, "This is my blood poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's do this together. Lord, it is well with our souls because of what you have done. Lord, today is a reminder of how it could not be well without you. You have forgiven us. You have set us free. You have protected us. You have died for our sins and washed us clean that we might be called the children of God. For that is who we are. Thank you, Father. Accept our worship, not just right now, but this entire week. Give us hearts of worship to the God who is willing to die for us, the God who is patient enough, the God who doesn't make us perform, but the God who truly changes. Thank you that the old is gone and the new has come. You're an amazing God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please stand with us. We sing this song. If you need prayer, if you need healing, if you need to come into this relationship with Jesus Christ that Pastor Jeff gave a tremendous message about this morning, then come forward. The angels rejoice even if one comes to know Jesus. Don't leave these doors this morning without beginning that relationship. We also must do something. We must confess that we're a sinner and ask Jesus into our hearts. So if you have not done that this morning, come forward. If you need prayer, come forward. Don't leave today. Stick around. Say hi to one another for a few minutes today before you depart. You alone can rescue. A very fitting song to end the service.
Oh, Lord God.
Now, for some of you, you are a bit confused. You're a bit confused because you don't fully understand, and you think that you're missing something that we all, the rest of us, have. Now, I know there's more than one of you who feels that way here this morning. So I ask you, please, humble yourself. We will celebrate with you. Please come forward over to this front pew. Johnny Santaswasa and Eric will come, and they will pray with you, and they will talk with you, and we will help answer those questions. The enemy loves to blind our hearts. He loves to blind them and throw us into confusion. So if you're sitting there like, you know what, I'm just not getting something. All these people are singing, and there's just joy, and they talk about all these things, and I just can't change myself. You're right. Please come forward. We'll pray that that darkness gets lifted, and that you can begin your relationship with Jesus Christ. So I ask you to please come. Because there's many of us who have felt that way and feel that way now. If there's anyone here who's just been performing, been spending way too much time trying to perform a life, and they want to get back into that relationship with God, come to the middle. We'll pray with you here. I want this entire front full of people who are praying for healing, praying for salvation, praying that God would begin anew in them. We're starting something new here at Trinity. If you don't feel it, if you don't see it, you're blind. You know God is doing something, and God is moving. We're not going to allow this church to sit still. We're not going to allow you to sit still. So join us. Come. Let's walk together. Let me pray, and then please come forward. Father, I thank you for your grace and your mercy. Lord, for those whose hearts you're knocking on now, who are standing there saying, God, I don't get this. It's okay. Lord, you have filled this church with people who will spur them on and who will pray with them. Lord, you're knocking because you want to open the door to them. So, Father, I pray that you would allow them to let you into their hearts. Lord, for those of us who have just put our lives on autopilot, probably for the last 2.5 years, and Lord, we have kind of put you on the back burner, and we've begun to perform. We just do Christian things. We don't live as children of God. Lord, I pray that you would bring them forward, and that you would bring forgiveness and renewed relationship. Bring a passion back in all of our lives. Holy Spirit, will you blow through with a new excitement and revival in this church? God, we know you're doing something. We see it. And we praise you. Thank you for this time of worship. I thank you for how great you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. There's a benevolent offering in the back for those who are in need.